So good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I will not start as far back as Guðni, 800 and something, but the topic is building up knowledge in small hydro society. I didn't choose it myself, but that's what I have to talk about. And I take Iceland as the example of a small society. And I will just run quickly through the development of hydro in Iceland, because that really connects absolutely into relates with the build-up of knowledge in hydro in the country. So hydro started quite early in Iceland, 1904 actually. There was a small hydro station built in a little town of Hafnarfjörður, south of Reykjavík, 9 kilowatt only, and that was just an entrepreneur who built it and used it for powering his carpentry shop. And that was it then. Then the next step was a small plant in the east of Iceland, close to the town of Seyðisfjörður, Fjarðarselsvirkjun. It was only 55 kV, but then it was later increased and extended, and it's still in condition to run, understand. This was in 1913. Then in the years around this, 1915, there were big plants here for making use of the enormous potential of the rivers here in the southwest, mainly, also in the north, though. And this was carried on by Icelandic entrepreneurs and foreigners as well. Wealthy men in England and Norway, and one of those was also a very famous Icelandic poet, Einar Benediktsson. And they actually designed a few big power plants on the Þjórsá River. Here is one, the Búrfell power station, designed from 1915 by Settismoen, Norwegian engineering company. But those plans did not materialize. That was abandoned, and it was not until 50 years later, really, that we went on the trip to utilize those big streams there. And so this was abandoned and not carried on. Next step was a small station here in Reykjavík in 1921, Elliðaárvirkjun. Small station, one or 1.5 megawatt in the beginning, but was then later increased. And this was used to power Reykjavík city, of course. And then the city of Reykjavík also built the station Ljósifoss power station, first with 2 units of 3.5 megawatts each. And this was the first major project, so to say. And they built a transmission line to Reykjavík to give the people in Reykjavík light and power to cook and eat. And then it was refurbished in 1997, 60 years later. It had been producing the same amount of power all the time since for 60 years, but did then need some refurbishment. And then later, they were built other stations on the same river. Any point here? No. Steingrímsstöð just further up, and Írafoss down below with actually Marshall help at that time. So people gained experience through these power plants. The owners, city of Reykjavík and others. There were other plants built during this time, smaller ones by the State Electric Power Works and small hydro in the countryside. But and then in the north, the same thing happened. Akureyri, the small town of Akureyri on the northern coast, they built Laxá 1 in 1939, and later then added 2 stations there, all the way up to 1973. And people participated in this as much as they were able to, the local people, of course. Then came the big jump to the Búrfell power station, which was the first really big hydro station in Iceland, 210 megawatt, built in 66 to 72 in 2 steps, first 3 units and then another 3. And this was decided to do, and also parallel to that, built an aluminium smelter in Reykjavík, close to Reykjavík, which was financed or owned by Alu Swiss at that time. And it was the economy of size and scale that was there being looked at to be able to provide cheap energy to the public by building such a big station, which was, of course, much bigger than Iceland needed at that time for their own public use. 80% of the power went to the aluminium smelter, like still is the case. And this was actually a turning point during this project. A lot of Icelandic technical staff and engineers, and of course also skilled workers, participated in the work as staff and employees and subcontractors to the foreign companies, but it was partly financed or helped by the World Bank, so there was a requirement to use foreign design and engineering and contractors as well. So it was basically all foreign, but with, of course, a lot of Icelandic staff, which helped build up this knowledge in Iceland. And then, yeah, this is just a quick picture of the aluminium smelter that was built at that time. Actually, one building has been added to it later. And this shows the enormous buildup of aluminium production in Iceland, which is incredible, actually. And I think it's still at this 2010 level now. And then, I have to jump over some of these. Then next thing was the Sigalda power station, which also was designed by foreigners and foreign engineering companies. The most extent, minor participation by local companies. It was Virkir, now part of Mannvit, but basically all foreign, and the contractors also were foreign. Of course, basically all electromechanical contractors are foreign, have been all the time and still are, basically. But also civil contractor was foreign at that time, and that was actually a Yugoslavian outfit called Energo Project. Then the next similar thing, Hrenjafoss, 210 megawatt, commissioned in 81, and there we also had foreign design, but with the participation of Icelandic engineering companies, VST at that time, now Verkis, part of Verkis. But contractors were more and more Icelandic. Ístak is one name that I could mention, and Hagvirki, Söðverk, they were already participating to quite an extent in the construction work. And actually, Landsvirkjun enhanced helped the local contractors by leasing strong and powerful construction equipment, because that wasn't available in the country. But then we come to Blanda, which is a milestone and a key thing. The Blanda power station, which is up north, 150 megawatt, three units underground, is the first station completely designed by Icelandic engineering staff. So there were no foreign part in this. And also the contractors were basically all Icelandic. And this was very successful. Landsvirkjun itself participated in this to a great extent, together with the locals here, the engineering companies. And that was a successful project that's been running now flawlessly since. And this was actually when we turned into fully Icelandic. Then after Blanda, there was a bit of a low pace. There was not much demand on the power intensive industry side. So we started refurbishing our old plants, like plants on the River Sog, the three there. I was involved in that actually. And also uprating of plants. We uprated the original Búrfell plant by 30%, by 60 megawatts, in view of increased inflow of water and climate change. So we were kind of benefiting from climate change already then. So that was operated and is at this capacity now. Then we continued here in Sultartangi. I'll jump over that. That's also a local design and local construction. Vatnsfell, the same, just to give a little overview of what we have been doing here in Iceland and what we based our knowledge and skills on. And this is the uppermost plant in our system. But we have a row of six plants on the same river scheme, Tuna og Þjórsá, six in a row now, and this seventh is being added, and there will be more, maybe. And sorry, and this is the mother of it all, the big thorax on the reservoir, which holds the water and the energy storage and reservoir for all these plants. Well, then we jump here to our big chunk, Kárahnjúkar, which is in eastern Iceland. You can see the blue ring. This was too big for Icelandic companies to cope with, so we had to make use of foreign engineering and foreign construction as well, but with participation of Icelandic companies. They were actually leading the design team, and that's a picture of it. We are quite proud of this. I was actually the head of project manager for this project, but it celebrates now 10 years of successful operation on 1st of November, when we commissioned five of the units. You can see that was quite a tough, it's a tough Arctic conditions, snow and cold, and which fits here to the theme of this conference. The contractors had to struggle there throughout all winter, and of course very remote people who lived far away from any civilization or villages, and snow and cold and wind and all. This is just inside the powerhouse, just to make a few glimpses. This is all what you see on the outside. It's all underground. 73 kilometers of tunnels. And I have to correct Guðni, you know, Guðni, we had a train already back on the Sog power stations, hauling, yes, rock to the dam. And on the Kárnuga project, we actually had 100 kilometers of trains inside of those tunnels by installed by the contractor, main contractor in Brazilu. So we have had trains actually since the harbor train here. It was all removed. There's just one wagon left and a piece of the rails. So this is just a section through it. I'll skip through this. See, it's a high pressure plant, 600 meters ahead, with pressure shaft equal to the Empire State Building. And the power, the decision was taken to build this in order to supply power to a big aluminum smelter in Reyðarfjörður, built by Alcoa. And 80% of the power basically goes there, but 20% is then available for the general grid. And these are the, put this here because these are very special constructions which are special for Iceland and the North, and we could offer this in other places in the North, Alaska or whatever, Canada or Greenland. These are snow avalanche towers, so slim to really cut the snow when it comes. And we of course face enormous ice and wind problems with where we can, I think, share knowledge in other countries. This is then the aluminum plant that is using the power from Kárnuga. I'll skip. This shows very well the enormous build-up of electricity in Iceland from 1930 or what. And it shows in red also geothermal. And something has been added since here. And I believe we are produce most electricity of all nations in the world per capita. Topul in Norway, I believe. Stole this from you, Guðni. So there's some minor increase since that was done. So based on all this experience and knowledge we have gathered, we formed the company Landsvikin Power, which deals with or offers consultancy abroad, consultancy advice and support abroad, together with our local partners, the engineering companies, Verkís, Mannvit, EFLA. We partner on projects in many that you can probably not read this map, but we are in Central America, in Canada, in Greenland, in Tanzania, in Africa and Georgia and many places. Here's an example from Greenland. We have four stations built by Icelandic contractor, Ístak, basically, and engineered or designed by Icelandic companies, and we have been part of it also, the operation. And there are some tough conditions. These are linemen from Landsnet, Icelandic linemen, servicing the power line. And we are all the way to Africa even, refurbishing hydropower plants there. I'm actually involved in that. And that takes care of my thing. This just shows all the stations of Landsvikin and the figures. I won't go through those. And just thank you for listening to this quick run through.